I've selected some submitted stories for us to read out on the worst hookup and the worst dating stories related to catfishing and anonymous profiles. So let's get into it. And for privacy purposes, we won't read out the names of the people or accounts who sent in their stories, but we have given you nicknames. Oh, and one little twist. One of these stories is actually my own experience. Can you guess which story is mine? I'll reveal which one at the end of the segment. But for now, Chris, please do us the honors of reading out the first story.
Okay, so Anon1 wrote in, I received nudes from a profile claiming to be 24 years old and looking for a quickie. I was on my lunch break while working from home and he wasn't too far from me, so I messaged back. He sent me face pics and I drove over. I knocked on the door and a voice told me to go around the back. I thought it was strange, but hey, maybe his room is closer to the back door, so I did what he said. As I got around the back, this 40 to 50 year old man approached me, telling me to go to the shed. I asked him if he was the guy I was messaging, and he said yes. I have no issues with age, but I am very confused. This guy was not 24 at all. Stupidly, I went to the shed where it was filled with power tools and one dirty bed with a spring mattress. I had sex with him and left in a hurry, but he demanded I give him $10 so he could get something to eat. And when I refused, he asked my bank account details so I could transfer him $50 instead, as he would need an Uber to get to McDonald's and back. Worst experience ever. Ladies, do not use Tinder. Oh my God.
Wow.
First of all, I love how you were able to admit that stupidly you went to the shed. Because like, was that not your first clue that maybe this is kind of a bit of a red flag and maybe we shouldn't do this? And then you go to the shed. Yeah, wow. I mean, I've never experienced this personally. But I can sort of understand like, okay, well, I'm here now. I might as well see how it goes. But I don't know. I need some time with this one.
Yeah. When it got to the part about the power tools, straight away my mind goes to horror movie territory. So I was like, oh shit, is this a Saw movie or
exactly dirty bed with a spring mattress? I'm like, this is American Horror Story, you know, Outback Shed or something. I don't know.
Yeah. When I got sent in this submission, it did come from someone I don't follow or someone that doesn't follow me. So it must have been a friend of a friend or whatnot. And when I read this, I thought, oh, okay. Can't say I've ever had an experience and like anywhere similar to this.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had times where I've turned up to some people's houses and their houses are, you know, absolutely filthy or they might be hoarders. And it's like,
look, well, it was 2016. Don't come after me. I'm kidding.
But like, I've never had to do anything that involves power tools. So
yeah. Mm-mm.
Yeah, honestly, thank God.
Yeah, also, you know, saying ladies do not use Tinder. Look, ladies, you do have to look out for yourselves because stuff like this can happen all the time. But I don't think this is the thing that you just not use Tinder. Like, I've had all of my dates, all my relationships have been through Tinder. You've just got to be a bit more careful. Like, this is definitely how you should not handle it.
Yeah.
You know, if there's clearly someone who's much older than they say they are, you know, I doubt a 40 year old is going to look similar to a 24 year old. But you know, it's like be more careful with yourselves. That's really all I can say. I'm also trying not to be a bitch, but yeah.
trust me, I'll be very bitchy throughout this whole series, especially when I talk about my own experiences. So,
well, I mean, that's your thing, so you can do what you want.
Speaking of which, our second story comes from Discreet By, and Discreet By writes in, "What's up? I live in a rural town where you see the same 15 guys on the app all day, every day. I could assume Tinder or Grindr, maybe. During Christmas 2019, a new guy popped up and he was fine as fuck, exactly my time. Right, definitely Grindr. We exchanged nudes and I offered for him to come around. When he showed up, I refused to answer the door as instead of my dream man, it was my ex-girlfriend from 5 years ago. We ended on bad terms when I told her I was bisexual and that I was breaking up with her to explore my sexuality. I'll take fault for breaking up with her as she did nothing wrong. At the time, though, I had hopes of moving to Melbourne and seeing whether I was gay, straight, or bisexual. I went outside hoping to talk to her. It took us 4 years to even get on a talking level, and I didn't want this to fuck up our friendship. She explained she was using an anonymous profile, but had used pictures of her current boyfriend to see if I was actually bisexual or not. Long story short, I identify as purely gay now, but I could somewhat see it from her side. We laugh about it now, but I feel I did something wrong. So I had to cut out a little bit of content from the original story for this one, because when it was sent in, it was just a lot more disparaging around the ex-girlfriend, and I just wasn't comfortable putting that aspect in. Also because, no offense to the person who sent in this story, but I can't believe you broke up with someone to explore your sexuality. I mean, if you are genuinely bisexual, couldn't you have just used any other method of closure for your girlfriend at the time?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I look at this story and I feel so bad for the ex-girlfriend that, yeah, what she did was bad with catfishing him using her current boyfriend's pictures. I wouldn't know who the current boyfriend looks like, by the way, for her to be this hung up on her ex-boyfriend. Mm. But at the same time, I'm just like, damn. Even when I identified as bisexual, I never had to put up with this because, you know, my every girlfriend I had was in high school. And even back then, it was so obvious I was clearly gay as opposed to bi. And like, don't get me wrong, some women I do think are very attractive, but I know I'm gay. So I'm so glad I've never had to put any woman through that type of pain of being like, oh, he left me because I turned him gay or whatever. It's like, no, girl, I was gay the whole time. Just took a while for me to realize.
Yeah. I mean, same thing with you. I no one's really the good guy here. I think both of you kind of did stuff that kind of fucked you guys over. You know. Sorry, I need my drink. I'm glad you can laugh about it now, but I'm glad you feel that you did do something wrong, because you did. So did she. I understand when you're, because I thought I was bi. I thought I was bisexual. I'm just like, I haven't found the right girl. Yeah, I'm just more physically attracted to men, but romantically more to women. Yeah, that didn't turn out true at all. It was just men. But I think breaking up with someone just to explore the sexuality, I agree with you, Justin. I don't think that was the right decision. You know, because, you know, people explore sexuality throughout multiple ages, you know, that doesn't really shouldn't matter. You know, if the relationship was dissolving, okay, like you gotta end like that, but purely just to explore your sexuality, yeah, I can't agree with that. I don't think that was a good move at all.
I also think too, why didn't he just have an honest conversation with her before the breakup?
Yeah.
And say, you know, I'm having these feelings of same-sex attraction. How do you feel about me like sleeping with men, or how do you feel about having an open relationship? Because that type of open relationship structure does work for some couples. Likewise, polyamory works for other couples too.
Yeah, so, yeah. I know quite a few people in throuples or open relationships, and they can make it work. I'm not sure if I could, but it clearly works. But it's really like everything's about communication. But having open relationships or a polyamorous relationship, way more communication, way more trust. It's tough. It's not easy, but it can work. And I just do not think this is the way to handle it.
Same. Likewise, I was just about to say, I like to think in my mind that I could handle a throuple or a polyamorous relationship or even an open relationship, but I'm someone that values my time. So the idea of having to manage two different people in a relationship or two or more people, I'm just like, oh, this is a logistical nightmare. I'm going to call one boyfriend and tell them I love him and everything. Then straight after that, I'm going to call the other boyfriend. So
you're also the jealous type, aren't you? They're very much the jealous type.
Not as much anymore, but definitely you ask any of my exes, they'll be like, yeah, he's the jealous type. So
yeah. I mean, I would be too, so I can't really talk.
It's just, I find in relationships, if I don't have at least a little bit of jealousy, like healthy jealousy, it means I don't necessarily like the person. So it's like, oh, you cheated? Oh, who cares? But if I actually like someone and I'm like, you cheated? You know, it's a different story.
Yeah, so. Exactly. I agree.
Now, this next story, holy shit. I had to do some digging for this one because I didn't believe it at first. I'll be honest. I went through it and I was like, I know the person who sent it in. I believe their side of the story. But at the same time, it just seems a bit too far-fetched. But anyway, Chris, do us the honors, please.
All right. So Wet and Wild wrote in, I love the name. Hello, hello. I agreed to a first date at Wet n Wild on the Gold Coast. Reason being that the girl I was talking to on Tinder named Rebecca was gorgeous and we both had season passes. She had a Facebook account linked too. We had a lot of common interests and I was so comfortable talking to her like I already knew her. We talked for a week before meeting up. I waited at the entrance and saw my best friend, Lachlan. Lachlan and I came here all the time, often as each other's wingmen. He would pick me up. He would help me pick up girls and I'd help him to pick up guys. And with him being gay, he was able to direct the girls my way. And likewise, I chat up gay guys in line and introduce them to Lachlan, even though I'm not gay myself. He told me he needed to tell me something and I had a sinking feeling. He confessed to me he was Rebecca, started crying, saying he wanted to tell me his true feelings, but he was scared of ruining our friendship. I left the theme park and didn't talk to Lachlan for 2 weeks. I called him to tell him I was very hurt by his actions and that him being attracted to me would never have caused an issue with our friendship. I'm a ripped, muscled lad with a career as a model, so I'm always surrounded by gay people and sometimes they hit on me. Hell, I'd be offended they didn't hit on me. What got me riled up was I was excited about meeting Rebecca, and for it to turn into a lie destroyed my faith in dating apps for a while. Lachlan and I have moved past this and are happily engaged to our future partners who we introduce each other to. We don't talk about it as it's uncomfortable for both of us. But if you share this story, I want people to know that the majority of straight people do not care if our gay friends are attracted to us, but please don't catfish us. Justin, is this your story?
No, straight off the bat, no. But my God, when I got sent in this story, it was over about 20 different messages on Instagram. And I was trying to like connect everything. So I was like, wait, is Lachlan Rebecca or is Lachlan like someone else? Is Rebecca real and whatnot? Because I couldn't make sense of the messages at first. So I got this person to send it as a voice message. And unfortunately, he wouldn't let me use it for the podcast. So I agreed to read it out. But going through it, I just have so many questions. One, why did his friend Lachlan just admit to it? Because I know I know plenty of delusional gays who, you know, they're the type of guys that are like, oh, I can turn straight guys. Yeah, the straight boys love me. And it's like, stop. No. What you do is you purposely prey on bi curious guys or guys who are actually bisexual. They just haven't told you that part because they know you only sleep with straight men. So they pretend to be straight. And likewise, I feel like there's some straight guys I've known, like whether it's high school, university, workplaces and whatnot. I find it's the opposite way around. The straight guys are always the ones trying to not get with me in a sexual sense, but it'll be something like, oh, I've always wanted to know what it's like to kiss a guy. And I'm like, yeah, well, keep wondering. I don't kiss coworkers. Or, you know, if it's a high school party, it'll be something like, you know, spin the bottle and like, you know, girls kiss girls, guys kiss guys. It doesn't matter. That's the part of the game and whatnot. It doesn't mean anything serious at the end of it. But
yeah.
I don't know. I always found, you know, going on a bit of a tangent here, but there were two guys in high school who were very straight. And I wouldn't say that I had a crush on them per se, but definitely thought they were attractive. And when I got to kiss them, it was like that feeling of like, oh my God, I can't believe this is happening, because, you know, never in a million years would I ever ask them to do anything like this because I know they're straight. And yet that was like the little, I guess, sneaky way of like getting kissed by straight guys and whatnot.
Yeah.
Now, when I look back, I do feel somewhat predatory because it's like, you know, why would I participate in spin the bottle or something like that? Because it was obvious, you know, well, for at least one of the guys anyway, they did not want to kiss another guy. But yeah. They also felt if they didn't kiss me, they might be labeled as homophobic. They might be labeled as, that type of language. And I was like, look, we don't have to do it if you don't want to. They're like, no, it's okay. You've been really nice to me. And they'll give me a kiss. And I'm like, holy shit, what the fuck? But at the same time, this Lachlan person, why didn't you just confess to him? He seems like an ally. I mean, he's helping you get laid by introducing you to other gay guys. So why would this person have a problem in the first place? I'm sure if you said to him, oh, I think you're really good looking and, I do have some feelings.
No, wait, this person's talking to gay guys for Lachlan.
Yeah,
you said the opposite, but all good.
My bad.
Yeah. Okay, first of all, I really resisted the urge to go, oh, Lachlan! Have you seen those? Oh, God. People whose name is Lachlan, they'll know I'm talking about their mums and just get a little bit of a PTSD. Sorry. but literally, like, oh, Lachlan, like, I understand kind of falling for a really nice straight guy that you're friends with and trying to find a way to see if I make a move and things might work out. I'm coming from experience here. But I clearly this person was not uncomfortable about the masculinity, the fact that they would talk to gay guys and then kind of send them your way. Yeah. The same way, because testing if they're good enough for you and for each other. That clearly proves that, there's really nothing that you should have hidden from each other, especially something like this. Yeah. It could have ended far worse, but you've moved past it and everything's all good now. But there's a lot of times where it doesn't happen. Mm. I'm not sure if you're aware of this, Justin, but and this is a very, very different world and very different thing. But I think it was like in the early 90s. I think it was somewhere in the 90s. There was someone who was on like this big, big talk show. This is in the US. And one of them confessed their love for one of their friends.
Jenny Jones.
It might have been that. I don't remember the full names, but it was all like embarrassing. It was like, oh my God, like he's actually attracted to you. And the friend who was attracted to, he was very clearly uncomfortable. And then I think it was like a few days later, the person who confessed his love for him and attracted to him ended up dead because that person killed him. Is that where you were? Are we talking about the same thing? Yeah. So that's the more extreme cases, but it can still happen. People don't want to feel trapped or anything. They don't want to feel yes, gay guys have to kind of hide and they kind of have to put up armor and do things to try and make things work out for them. But sometimes I think we can be a little bit too manipulative and especially emotionally manipulative. This felt really, really emotionally manipulative. I mean, the fact that you're basically, again, you're catfishing. As this Rebecca, and it feels like you've been talking to her for ages. It has been. Like, you see TV shows where they do this, and it's like, okay, it was coming from a good place, but it's also like, yeah, this is really fucked up because you've made someone feel like, oh my God, someone actually understands me, which is really, really hard to get in this world we live in. And then it turns out to be fake. Yeah. You had every right to be pissed off with Lachlan. Lachlan! So again, glad you moved past it, but Lachlan was in the wrong here, definitely in the wrong.
Oh, 100%. And also,
sorry, long tangent.
no, that's fine. I feel like if I had a friend like Lachlan who was my wingman but then betrayed me like this, I don't know if I could be friends with him again, because I'd always be wondering, if I meet up with someone from Tinder or from Grindr, is it going to be that friend? Mm-hmm. So I'm just shocked.
Yeah.
Not as shocked as the next story, though. This story only got sent in a week ago, and I had already done up the run sheet for this podcast and everything. And I thought, oh my God, I have to include this one. Mm. Also, because this story, it does come from a friend of mine in my old hometown of Orange. So I need to tell it.
Sorry. I lived in a place called Red. No, I'm kidding.
Blue. No. Heya. Oh, sorry. Let me restart that one. So this story comes from Secret Santa. She writes, "Heya, a few years ago, I was working as a Santa elf in a shopping center where I was required to put on an elf costume and pose alongside Santa for some pictures with kids and families. Now, I'd been warned by management that oftentimes some of the teenagers and dads would try and ogle me or even try and touch me, but nothing could have prepared me for what happened. On my fourth shift, there was this creepy guy that kept looking over in my direction with his mouth wide open. I ignored him as I was busy working. It's hard being a model. We were given an iPhone with a direct mobile number to answer customer inquiries, and just as we were about to pack up our chute, the phone rang. This creepy voice said, 'I would have bent you over behind the North Pole. How would you like for Santa to empty his sack?'" Feels disgusting just even reading that out. Anyway.
I'm very uncomfortable.
I hung up, continued packing up, and headed for my car. As I was putting costumes, tinsel, and my bag in the boot, this voice startled me. "Hey, sexy lady." Oh, God. I'm trying to do the impressions. I just can't do it. So I'm going to read it out as normal. "Hey, sexy lady," I heard. I turned around, and it was the creepy guy that was staring at me before. Only now, he was in a Santa suit, but missing the hair and the beard. I didn't know what to do, so I said hello. He tells me he's a new Santa hire for the competing shopping center and asks if I would like to ride him on his sleigh. Sorry, I shouldn't be laughing. This is a very serious story. Anyway, I would ask if I would like to ride him on his sleigh before dropping his pants as he began touching himself. I quickly got into my car and drove out of the shopping center. I reported him to the police and to the competing shopping center. And while he was indeed, I quickly got into my car. I reported him to the police and to the competing shopping center. And while he was arrested and later charged, the competing shopping center accused me of making this up to damage their competing business. They stressed they didn't have any Santas that fit my description of the guy. I can't tell if they were trying to cover it up, but I haven't had any other experiences like this. So, holy shit, I know exactly which shopping center that she worked at because it's this very famous shopping center in Orange. One of my juniors, Harriet, who probably listens to this podcast, she'll know exactly what I'm talking about too. Mm-hmm. And it's always this Santa display outside of Big W. There's always long lines. Usually they have a few of these like young girls between like 18 to 30 who have to wear these revealing elf costumes. So it's like lots of cleavage, short skirts. And I remember being in Orange for Christmas about 5 or 6 years ago. And you do see, it's always the dads as opposed to like teenage guys. The dads always make creepy comments like, "Oh yeah, like to have you under my tree." And it's like, dude, what the fuck? Like, shut the fuck up, Uber.
God. So just as a little bit of humor here, seriously, if you're going to dress as Santa, you're not going to do the hair and the beard. Like, at least commit. That's just the actor in me coming out. But oh my God, you know, you hear like you hear some creepy stories about like Santas and like mall Santas. Oh my God, they're awful, or like, you know, they're not particularly great. I do love your line. It's just hard being a model. But yeah, it actually is. You know, you kind of have to look a certain way and you have to move a certain way. And you know, I work in a place where we've hired out like showgirls and performers that have to dress in rather skimpy ways and are very, very conventionally attractive and everything. And sometimes you really have to watch out for people who will try and cop a feel. And it does happen. It's gross and it is awful, but it does happen. Good news. You're one of the few people in the story so far that I'm not going to blame you. You did absolutely nothing wrong. But yeah, there's just a lot of ick when it comes to this. The competing shopping center saying like you're making this up to damage that, like, that is such a you know, you see it all the time in really bad movies. They're like, oh, they're making it up to try and ruin reputation, but clearly it does happen. that is ridiculous. I hope that, yeah, I know, yes, he was arrested and later charged, but I don't know. I feel like the shopping center should have gotten something for, you know, dodging that kind of, yeah. It wasn't even like a accusation against that business. That was just, yeah, that was just what he said. So that's not your fault, Dom. Secret, yeah, Santa.
Oh, and
you know, I'm going to feel uncomfortable whenever I hear Secret Santa now. I'm just going to think back to this story. I'm like, ick.
When I got sent in this story, I thought, because, you know, all the responses that I got and everything, I was like, well, people could easily make up stories. So, you know, I'm going to do a little bit of digging from my own end. I did come across, and Orange has this paper called the Central Western Daily. So they have like a court report every 2 weeks, I think it is. And I did go back through all the court reports, and there was indeed someone. There we go again. I keep saying the word indeed. I don't know why.
Indeed. Where's your monocle?
I know. I need to dress like the Monopoly man, but there was this one
person. You had the mustache for it too recently. You had a little twirl. It was so good.
Oh, I missed the twirl. Just, I can't. Every time I would like curl it up, 5 minutes later, we're just going, boing, 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 and just like do this weird, like Texan style. Like, it was awful.
Oh, God.
But there was this person who was charged in this court report in the Central Western Daily paper. Mm. And I was like, oh, holy shit, this is word for word, almost the exact same story. Of course, the person who sent in their submission was able to give me like all the details about what this person said, also named the shopping center, but just for legal purposes, so I don't get sued for this podcast. I can't name it, but you know, it's something where I'm like, that does not surprise me at all. My older sister lives directly near the competing shopping center, and let's just say it's like almost like a it's like a hotspot for like your crazies of Australia. So like, you know, your junkies, you've got like everyone screaming for like cigarettes and alcohol. So
we've definitely got a few suburbs that are the the hotspot for that kind of thing. There are quite a few suburbs in here in Perth that definitely fill that description.
Oh, it's just, I was so happy to get some stories about Orange, because I had some stories received from like their Bucket Heads, Barrowville, a lot of stories from Sydney, and I was like, I'd like to get at least one story from the place I grew up in for the first 10 years of my life.
Yeah, come on, who's got a fucked up story? Come on.
Yeah, like, I'm basically chasing down everyone at this point, like, asking my own sister, my own friends from primary school, being like, do you have a bad date story? You should send it to me and I'll read it out. And they're just like, dude, no, I married my girlfriend when I was 20. And I'm like, shit.
How dare you be happy? Give Justin content.
Now, this next story that I received, this was one of the very first ones. And I'll be honest, I thought that this was almost copied word from a Reddit post. Like, what is it? Subreddit, am I the asshole, or subreddit, dating advice, those type of things. But I couldn't find this anywhere else on the internet. So in my mind, it's genuine. But I have some questions, but I'll ask these questions after. So, Chris, please do us the honors.
Our final story comes from Datey180, and they write, hi, not sure if this is appropriate, but a few months ago, I was catfished twice in a row by the same person. I'm what you would call a future trad wife, i.e. I don't sleep around, I'm looking for Mr. Right to marry and having children with. Having a family has always been a dream. And yes, I may be 22, but I'm looking to start my family now. The first time it happened was on Bumble. I matched with a guy who looks similar to Evan Peters, hopefully not the Jeffrey Dahmer look. We talked on the phone after exchanging numbers. He asked to take me on a date and I happily said yes. We met at the local vegan cafe and I couldn't find him. This young boy around 17 or 18 waved me down. He claimed to be the guy I was on the phone to the night before. But this boy was at least 10 years younger and looked nothing like the guy in the Bumble profile. I asked him for his age and he said it didn't matter. I brought up my phone and asked him who the person that the profile was. He told me I was crazy for asking questions and that I don't need to worry about that. He asked me what food I wanted and I politely declined. He said, are you being fucking serious right now? What is it with bitches like you? You're only interested in guys with money, but freak out at any real shot at true love. He kicked the table over and we were escorted out of the cafe. I raced back home alone and I'm afraid he will follow me. A few weeks went by and I matched on Tinder with a handsome 30-year-old named John. He was suave and he talked about how he was looking to start a family and be in a serious relationship. We agreed to meet at Sirens. We agreed to meet at Sirens in Darling Harbour. I waited just outside the restaurant to see if I could spot him and also to fix my hair and dress. When I saw the same guy from the previous day who catfished me, I messaged him asking where he was. He replied he was waiting at the front for his princess. Okay. I blocked his number and asked a group of women nearby if I could walk with them until I got to my bus. The lovely girls were so kind and even offered to come with me on the bus, but I felt safe. I'm still looking for Mr. Rye, but I'm now extra cautious and asked to do video calls before I meet anyone. Yes, that last line. Yes. Like, the exchanging photos isn't even the best anymore. I mean, I don't generally do the video thing, but I think that's a great idea. Or, yeah. Well, usually I just go like, okay, no, I'm meeting in public place, meeting someone in cafe. Not even a bar, because bar could end up not well. So usually it's cafe for me, but here we go. Yeah, like this is a bit local vegan cafe and the same thing happens. So maybe a video thing is the way to go. So I'm so glad you learned from your mistake and being extra cautious. This is what we're supposed to do. This is the correct response after having this kind of story. First of all, meeting the princess. I'm sorry. I immediately when I see like, are you being effing serious? What is with bitches like you? Only sitting guys with money, but freak out any real shot at true love. I feel like I'm listening to an Andrew Tate fan experience. Because no. Okay. So people, if you're gonna go out there and say I'm a nice guy, it's like I know you didn't watch Game of Thrones, Justin. I remember you saying it. Did you? No, yeah, yes, you did. Yes, you did.
Wait, Game of Thrones?
No. Yeah, Game of Thrones. Yeah. So one of the quotes on there was, you know, the king at the time was this like super bratty teenage kid. And his grandfather was like, any man who says I am the king is no true king, which is really true, because the fact that you have to say what you are kind of proves that you're not, you know, you're trying to prove that you're, if you're a nice guy, you don't have to say it. You know, but this was horrible. This was really, really awkward to read. It's funny. Someone just was talking to me about Bumble and how good it was. Now I'm sort of like turned off by it, so maybe I could try Hinge, but anyway, this thing can happen on any apps. It doesn't really matter where you go to. While I do think, and you know, everyone looks for what they look for, but I think being 22 and looking for Mr. Ryan and starting a family now, personally, I think you should wait a little bit more before you jump into that. But again, this is your journey. You decide what you want. But yeah, it's really just a cautionary tale of what can happen when you're really just looking for that Mr. Ryan. Match with the guy looks similar to Evan Peters. I mean, I'd swoon over that too. Again, not the Jeffrey Dahmer look. But yeah, young boy, 17, 18. Like, how many times do kids that age often know what they want?
Yeah.
Or yeah, it just, I think he just wanted a really pretty girl just to show to his mates or something just to make him feel a bit better. Not excusing what he's doing, because this is a really shitty behavior. But you know, good on you for like asking a group of women to walk with them and they were so lovely to you. Like, hey ladies, can we like support each other? Gays, can we support each other? That'd be really cool. Keep doing that.
I would love to see more of that. I also want to stress as well, so this is, I think, the only story / submission I received where it was a teenager catfishing someone. Yeah. Every other aspect has been like a 30-year-old catfish, a 45-year-old catfish, a 50-year-old catfish. Never anyone under the age of 20.
Yeah.
And I will admit I was a bit surprised by that, because that MTV reality show, which has been going on for 600 years at this point, you know, my little sister watches every episode. I've watched every episode. I looked quite popular with teenagers, that I would think there would be a lot more teenage catfishers in the world, but it tends to be people in their late 20s and 30s.
Yeah. So, which I feel a bit attacked when it comes to that, because I'm in that age group now. but yeah, this just read to me as someone who was very lonely, either very recently out of high school or still in high school, and just kind of wanted the big pretty lady to feel better about themselves. But, you know, that is not worth being, you know, taken as a trophy catch to. Yeah. I don't really have much else to say on that, but, you know, good for you. Good for you for being extra cautious. Yeah, that's really all I can say.
And shout out to the girls too, that immediately just helped this person, you know, get to the bus. That's something which I would love to see more of. I'm sure it does happen more and more than what we think, but I think of Cindy in this context. If I had been catfished by someone, or if I was in a dangerous situation, I would bet all my money. If I went up to a group of gays, I was like, help, someone's trying to harm me, they'd be like, ew, you're not a size 3.
I'm sorry, like, your gut is like showing a bit too much. Whatever, yeah. Whatever.
And like, if I was a twink or muscle bound or whatnot, they'd be like, oh, babe, just come to my place. And
I'm
okay.
I recently just finished watching Please Like Me again. And yeah, that really reinforces that ideal, that that stereotype. Oh, I hate gay dating.
I don't know your views on him, but I do not like Josh Thomas. So.
Yeah, he actually reminds me of my first ex. No, he actually does. He behaves like him, dresses like him, has a very similar face to him. I just think Josh Thomas has prettier eyes than him. But yeah, that's basically my first ex. 19-year-old myself, I hated him.
My two partners that I had at the age of 19, not at the same time, you know, broke up with one, got a new partner, blah, blah, blah. I'm actually still good friends with them to this day, but sometimes, and this isn't to disparage them, but I do look back and I think, we definitely worked better as friends. Why did I think a relationship would work? But, you know, that's part of growing up. You know, you think you're doing what's best. So like, especially in my case, I was definitely trying to force the relationship as opposed to let it happen naturally. And, you know, thank God we were able to work past breakups and everything. We're good friends, you know. Actually, fun story. I feel like I'm better friends with their married partners now. So, you know, like, we catch up every now and then, or we'll play video games or just talk by text. They'd be like, oh, how was your day? Hope everything's good, da 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 da. Whereas my actual exes, I don't really talk to that much. So. Yeah. But anyway.
Oh, well, there you go.
So, it is time for me to admit which story is actually mine. All so, right. Chris, which story do you think is mine?
Okay, so I tried to guess that the model one was it, just because it was like, I'm a ripped muscle lab with a career as a model, and I thought maybe he threw that in just to throw it off. I am going to say the first story was yours.
You are correct.
So, yes! Sorry, that was too loud.
The real story is even stranger than what I actually wrote. So I purposely changed the gender, said that the first story was a girl that met up with someone, used Tinder. What actually happened was, and this is probably the second scariest experience of my life. So last year, I was working from home and I had about an hour lunch break. And I was just really in the mood, you know, I'd just gone through a breakup with someone. So I was like, I just really want to go out and just sleep with a whole bunch of people, because that's what I do after breakups. And there was this person who messaged me claiming they were 28. And, you know, they said face pictures. And I'm not someone who needs like body pictures or anything, so I don't really care about that shit. But they sent different face pictures. It said they were nearby. So I was like, well, all right, I'll go. I haven't had any other bad experiences this year.
Mm.
But plot twist, actually a lot more bad experiences after that. But anyway, so I drove to this person's house who was about a 3-4 minute drive.
Mm.
And when I got to the front of the place, it was like this big mansion. And I was like, ooh, this person has some money. You know, this is great. Mm. So knocked on the front door and there was a voice that said, oh, just go around the back. I'll be right there. And in my mind, I thought, oh, maybe if I go around the back, you know, it's just an easier way to get to like the upstairs bedroom or something. Because there's some places like that. Mm. When I walked around the back, you know, the backyard was immaculate. It was like freshly cut grass and there were all these garden features. Ooh. And then this man walks out and he must have been early 40s, mid 40s. And look, I'm someone who's been sleeping with guys in their 40s and like, you know, stuff like that since I was like 22. Mm. So that is definitely one of my types. And I was like, sorry, are you? And he goes, yeah, what? It's me. I was like, oh, you said your age was 28. He's like, yeah. He never denied that he wasn't 28, but he just looked older. Yeah. And I was like, okay, whatever. I don't care. I'm already here. And he goes, oh, just wait here for a minute. So he goes back into the house and I'm thinking maybe he's going to put pets away or maybe he's just going to like tidy up his room or something. Mm-hmm. And then he comes back out and just grabs my head and leads me to this shed. When he started walking me to the shed, I straight away was just like, no, what the fuck is going on?
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know what to do because he had such a like grip tied on my arm. And then get into this shed, there were power tools on the walls and it was like very fancy pants, you know, like lined up with like magnets and shit. I started freaking out thinking, how do I get out of this situation alive? Because I don't know this person. I don't know what's going to happen. Anyway, I am going to get a bit graphic, but, you know, I started topping him. And as I'm topping him, I'm thinking, please, can I just hurry up and finish so I could go the fuck home?
Yeah.
You know, I don't care what's happening. But because I was too panicked and I was too scared, I just wasn't in it. But at the same time, he would not let me finish until I finished. So I was like, fuck, what do I do in this situation? Anyway, after about 10 minutes, he gets out his phone. He starts calling all these electricians, tradies, plumbers, and he's telling them in graphic detail about what I'm doing to him, saying like, yeah, this guy's fucking me right now. How would you like to come over and be the next one? And, you know, 99% of these tradies, plumbers, etc., would just hang up and be like, what the fuck? Like, I thought this was a call for someone to be like, oh, my house lost power. Not a fucking invite to come fuck this person. So then I saw my way out. This one electrician was like, oh, okay. And the guy was like, yeah, do you want to come over? And he goes, yeah, send me your address. And I thought, oh, thank God, like, this person's going to come and like take over and I can just leave and get the fuck out. But another 10 minutes went by. I'm nowhere close to finishing. I'm not enjoying myself at all.
Mm-mm.
And then I thought I would just pretend that I had finished.
Mm-hmm.
And so that did not work because I'm the worst actor on the planet. He looks at me, turns around, grabs me and he goes, you're not finished yet. And then just puts it back in. And
I was no.
Jesus Christ, like, what's going on? Oh, I was so nervous. And then I just thought, you know what? I'll just think of my favorite porn star and that'll get it going for me.
Mm.
And then I realized after I'd finished, the condom broke. And I was like, oh,
no.
I was freaking out even more. And then I thought, hold on, maybe this person might not be HIV positive. He might not have any STIs and whatnot. But then as I'm like putting on my pants and my shirt, this other electrician calls him back to be like, hey, I'm at the front, where are you? And the guy goes, oh, I'm just in the shed. I've already taken 6 HIV positive loads. How would you like to be the 7th one? I immediately just go ballistic.
And I'm
like trying to get out the door. And then he asked me to give him $10 so he can get some food. And I said, no. And he goes, well, okay, what about bank transfer? And I said, no. I don't have my phone on me. And he goes, you got your phone right there. I was like, yeah, but I don't have the CommBank app. And he goes, well, when you get home, can you transfer me 50? And I said, yeah, sure, but I've just got to rush home, thinking, like, just let me get out of this shed, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, like, he opened the door. I started walking away. When I, like, unlocked the side gate, if you like, around the other side of the gate is his mum. And she's sitting on a lawn chair. And she goes, oh, you were quick.
What the fuck?
What is going on? Is his mum a pimp? Is she, like, keeping people, like, you know, in the backyard for a reason or something?
Yeah. Justin, I feel like you were close to being the first victim of a serial killer origin story.
Yes.
Because that is royally fucked up. I gotta say it.
I can laugh about it now because a small part that I left out was when I got into my car, he then bangs on the side of the car window and goes, can you give me a lift? And I went, no, I've got to go to work. He's like, oh, well, don't forget the $50. Instead, I got home. As soon as I got home, I was freaking out. I called the local, health clinic, being like, I've just slept with someone who, you know, has just told me that he's taken HIV positive loads. What can I do? Because I don't want HIV, you know? And so I went to the clinic. They put me on HEP, which is post-exposure prophylaxis.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to take those tablets for 28 days. They made me so nauseous in the first week. But small price to pay, because now that the three-month window has passed, you know, I'm HIV negative. I still take PrEP now. And the thing was, I've usually always been safe, like wearing condoms and whatnot. The only time I haven't really worn that for, like, penetration wise was when I was a teenager. Because when you're a gay teenager, you don't think of HIV or STIs. You think, oh, I don't need to wear one because I can't get my guy pregnant. So I was like, but, like, that story doesn't even, like, come close to this other experience I had, which I'll talk about later in the episode. It is last year was, like, the year of just, like, absolute worst experiences of my life. And, you know, all I can say is, thank God I'm dating someone now who
actually doesn't do that. Yeah.
Doesn't have a shed.
You know what? This was a recent story, was it not?
Yeah, I think I messaged you about it.
I think this is a story you were telling me about, or at least how it happened. Like, you told me a few things, but not, like, all the details. And now I know all the details. And that's scary. Sydney's terrifying. You're really not selling it to a Westerner over here.
Oh, honestly, it doesn't even matter what part of Sydney. It could be the middle of the city. It could be the nice affluent areas. It could be Western Sydney. It could be Bondi Beach or Northern Beaches. There are terrible people in every single part. So it happens that two of my experiences have been in Western Sydney. So
I guess the right story.
Honestly, at least it gave me some good content for me to actually talk about. So
yeah,
you know, and on the plus side, I'm now able to be, oh, sorry, I forgot to leave out as well. This guy gave me gonorrhea. So that was also fun to find out, you know.
Yeah.
What has it been, like, 13 years of, like, being sexually active, you know, always doing my regular STI health tests, etc. This is the only time that I've ever tested positive for anything. Mm. And I was like, okay, gonorrhea. But then also having the whole scare factor for 3 months, thinking, fuck, what if I am HIV positive? And, you know, there's always options out there, you know, so that even if you are HIV positive, you are untransmissible, so you don't pass it on to someone else. But at the same time, it's always just scary because, you know, we've always been taught our whole lives that if you have HIV, HIV turns to AIDS, but that's not necessarily the case.
No. But, you know, things have developed a lot since the 80s, but it's still something you have to be really cautious about.
Yeah.
Justin.
Honestly, I should just make, like, a horror film and just call it The Shed.
Well, yeah, that's what I said. Like, this was very much a serial killer origin story, or at least maybe, like, the intermission. before like the big climax of the thing. So who knows what's happening to him right now, what he's doing.
I did try and get in charge because, you know, I'm a very petty person by nature. So
no,
I know, shocking. I contacted the police after I went to the sexual health clinic and I said, look, this is what happened to me. He lied about his HIV diagnosis before we did anything. He lied about his age. He catfished me. And the police just went, oh, but he told you afterwards he was HIV positive, right? And I said, no, not technically. He just said he had taken HIV positive loads. And the cops just went, oh, okay, but you're already protected because you got PEP, right? And I was like, yes, but what if he does this to someone else? And they go, oh, well. And I'm thinking, my God, like, can't you just like drive? I have his address. I have his photos. Like, can't you just go and talk to this person and say, hey, that's not on? Or do something at least, but the cops don't give a shit.
No.
Nah. Anyway, enough about my own sex life.